here right now. Hey, welcome to Hannity. And tonight, brand new Fox News polls have been released. Donald Trump leads nationally with 34%. Senator Ted Cruz is in second with 20%. Senator Marco Rubio in third place with 11%. Now, they're followed by Dr. Ben Carson, Jeb Bush, and John Kasich. Here with reaction from the Weekly Standard, Steve Hayes, the co-host of the hit show The Five, Kimberly Guilfoyle, and the host of the other hit show on the weekend, the host of Justice, Judge Jeanine Pirro. Good to see you all. All right. Really, I think national polls don't matter. It's all about Iowa, all about New Hampshire. Two polls yesterday had Trump up by 11 and 10, respectively. Does that seem to mean late-breaking people are beginning to go towards him in Iowa?
Yeah, it seems that the undecided at this point are going with Donald Trump. Donald has predicted if he wins Iowa, you know, almost game over. And this hit by the National Review is something that is totally inconsistent with what the people want.
Yeah, you know, it is interesting, but this is not the first time. They did this to Newt in December of 2011. Prior to the last race, and actually claimed that he wasn't a conservative.
Did they do it to Mitt Romney, the guy who started Obamacare, or did it like a...
No, they did it to Newt Gingrich, the solid conservative that brought Republicans into power for the first time in 40 years. KG, what do you think of both the polls and National Review?
I think the polls are consistent with the momentum and what we've been seeing in terms of the traction and the amount of, you know, media attention, the way that he's been a newsmaker. And look, he's working very hard, Trump is, to get these numbers. He's out there. He's doing more interviews than anyone else. So this is how you earn it. This is how you win it. And as for National Review, I was quite frankly, I was a little bit disappointed and surprised. I want to see a Republican in the White House, and I want someone who's going to win. And I don't think it's right at this point to be cannibalizing one another.
Well, Steve Hayes, let me ask you this. And my first thought when I read this, and there are some people I really like a lot that signed on to this, but where was National Review when, in fact, the Republicans were going back on their promise against repealing and replacing Obamacare and using the power of the purse, or holding up the mantle of challenging a sitting president and stopping executive amnesty, which was the Republican promise in 2014. I didn't see any special National Reviews, Republicans do this. You know,
well,
I think there's a valid criticism.
Certainly, certainly National Review has been leading the fight in many ways. With the Weekly Standard and others challenging the Washington establishment and the crony capitalists here in Washington. I mean, you think
some have been excellent. You're
authors
right.
Like Andy McCarthy and Rich Lowry has done that. Jonah Goldberg has written those articles suggesting that the establishment, the people in Washington,
but not a special edition headline.
Cozy.
That's right.
Yeah, I think that they thought that this Trump ascendancy was worth a special edition, and it includes a number of people. I mean, it's interesting for me to see people try to cast National Review and these contributors as part of the Washington conservative establishment. It's preposterous. I mean, it includes authors like Eric Erickson, like Brent Bozell. I mean, nobody's calling these people establishment. So I think that's just the wrong thing, and nobody should be surprised when an opinion magazine has opinions. That's what they do. They're perfectly within their rights to do it. They're not on a team. They don't have to pump anybody up. They can do whatever they want.
I'm not critical at all. Rich Lowry's a friend. I want to be very clear about that. Yeah.
He's our friend. There's no question.
Yeah.
But this smacks of the establishment pushing back on the Republican Party. Donald Trump is the favorite of Republicans. And for them to come out and say if he gets elected, he's going to trample conservative ideals on behalf of populism as needless and crude as Donald. Are they saying that we are crude, that we don't know what we need? It's almost like Obama's saying, I know what's good for you. Don't tell us what's good for us. We know what's
It's a magazine. It's an opinion magazine. They have opinions. They back them up. I think they argued quite persuasively that Donald Trump isn't a conservative, hasn't been a conservative, and would do damage to the conservative movement. People are perfectly free to disagree with them and make arguments, but the implication that it's somehow improper for a magazine of opinion to make these arguments is preposterous.
But let me read what they said about Gingrich in December of 2011. Gingrich's colleagues were right to bring his tenure as speaker to an end, his character flaws, his impulsiveness, his grandiosity, his weakness for half-baked ideas made him a poor speaker of the House. They even accused him of not being a conservative. Mm. So, Kimberly Guilfoyle, I ask you this question. I think Steve's right. For 7 months, people have questioned the legitimacy of Donald Trump's conservatism. Mm-hmm. Clearly, a lot of people believe that he would, at least populist, he's going to control the borders. He's going to have a tough plan on ISIS. Economic, he's laid out his plan. I think they've made their case for a long time now, and it doesn't seem to have hurt him.
No, I don't think. I think this is actually going to help him.
Why?
I really do, because I think it's going to motivate his supporters and people that don't want to be preached to say, listen, I'm going to support who I believe can take this country in the right direction. He's been able to turn things like this into positives time and time again. And that's why he's been sucking all the oxygen out of the room from the other candidates. You see him with a commanding national lead. You see him now gaining again in Iowa. So I wait and see what happens. And if he takes Iowa, then I predict that he's going to take the other three.
You know, Steve, a lot of what was written here talked about Trump's temper. And I remember a guy who I love to interview, and I thought the world of William F. Buckley. And I could play, although I'd probably get in trouble, some highlights of debates that he had with Gore Vidal. Were not exactly peace-loving moments of civility.
Yeah. No, I mean, and look, politics can be a very tough sport, and people who enter this business, either as a candidate or on the opinion side, should be well equipped to take arrows and slings and everything else. Having said that, I do think that Donald Trump is a little bit different. I do think that, you know, if you look at the kinds of arguments he's made, whether mocking Carly Fiorina's face or denigrating John McCain for his war heroism, making fun of a disabled reporter,
okay,
all
but
of
Ted
those
Cruz
things,
hasn't
it seems
done
to me,
that. And
would
the same
would
people
suggest...
you mentioned, a lot of which hate Ted Cruz. So it's going to be an insurgency year one way or the other. And I think that has a lot of people shaken up.
Well, look, I'm not making an argument for or against Ted Cruz. I'm just saying, to answer your specific direct question about Donald Trump, I think if people have questions or concerns about his character or temperament, whatever word you want to use, I think it's fine for people to have those and to
We've
express those. And I'm a little
months.
Surprised that more conservatives who support Trump don't share those concerns, honestly.
Look, here's the bottom line. The establishment is scared. Donald Trump is beholden to no one. The American electorate knows it. The Republicans know it. And the fact that there aren't these attacks against Ted Cruz, pro-amnesty, now he's against it.
Oh, they're out there.
Alone.
In fairness, by the way.
Yeah, but I didn't see front page articles, people joining together. This is the one hand.
No, you've got Bob Dole. You've got Trent Lott.
Right.
You've got every Republican in D.C. hates him. I would argue, Kimberly, because Ted Cruz embarrassed them because he was willing to fight and use the power of the purse to defund Obamacare, and he embarrassed them.
Right, and my point simply is I just feel like the party should come together at a certain point. If they're going to do this, maybe do it sometime early. This seems to me to be a little bit pro-Cruz in terms of doing this to maybe shave points off of Donald Trump going into Iowa, which, hey, it's
last question, I want to ask yes or no. Will we have an insurgent nominee for the Republican Party?
We will not only have an insurgent nominee, we will have a president who's an insurgent.
I like the judge's pick.
Right.
The ruling
Steve Hayes.
Is in.
Yeah, I'd say better than a 50-50 chance that it'll be either Ted Cruz or Donald Trump.
Yeah. I'd say it's more like 90-10 at this point. Well, we'll see.
Put your bucks down in Vegas.
Thank you, guys.